Penguin Random House Audio presents Keep You Close by Karen Cleveland. Read for you by Erin Bennett. The truth is rarely pure and never simple. Oscar Wilde. Prologue. The woman jolts awake, gasping, heart pounding. Gunshots echo in her head, ones conjured in sleep. She reaches for the other side of the bed, finds it empty. Only an indentation in the sheets, now cold. She slips out of bed and shrugs on a robe, pads quietly into the darkened hall, bare feet cold on the wood floor. She peers through the first open door. A boy sleeps soundly, his features barely visible by the light of the moon. On to the next door. A little girl asleep in a rainbow-colored room, a nightlight casting a muted glow on her innocent face. Third door now. Twin boys, asleep in twin beds. One has a thumb in his mouth. The other is snuggled up with a tattered stuffed bear. Faint sound from downstairs draws her onward. Television, the volume low. She glimpses the screen when she's halfway down the stairs. News, the 24-hour kind. Russia. Election interference. The sort of story her husband can't stand, always shuts off. A few steps more, and the rest of the room comes into view. The living room, cluttered with plastic toys and board games, mantle full of family pictures. And a figure in the center of the room, bathed in flickering blue light from the television. Perched on the edge of the couch, watching the screen intently. The unnatural light distorts his features. For a moment, he looks like a stranger. He seems to sense her presence, turns toward her, and his face breaks into a familiar, comforting smile. He mutes the television. Another nightmare, sweetheart. He extends an arm, an invitation to sit beside him. She doesn't move, only nods in response to his question. He stands, aims the remote at the television, and the picture disappears. They're plunged into darkness. Let's go back to bed. He walks toward the stairs, toward her, but her eyes haven't adjusted, and he's nothing more than a hulking shadow. He lays a hand gently on her back. She shrinks away from it. I'm going to stay down here. He hesitates, then stoops to kiss her cheek, brushes past her up the stairs. She watches him until he's gone. Alone in the darkness, she cinches her robe tighter, looks into the living room at the television screen, now black. In her mind, she sees that expression on his face. Almost a smile, a twisted one. But it couldn't be, because it looked nothing like the man she knows, the man she loves. She tries to convince herself it was just the light. That unnerving blue flicker from the television. They don't have secrets, not anymore. Still, a shiver runs through her. She wraps her arms around herself. What if he's not who she thinks he is? How well does she really know him? Chapter 1. Nighttime's always been my favorite time to run. I like the stillness, the quiet streets, empty sidewalks. It's not the safest time to be out, sure, but in running gear, it's not like I have much to have stolen. And as far as assault, I'm tougher than I look. Trained in defense tactics, able to hold my own. It's the non-random crime that worries me more. But if someone's coming after me, they'll find a way to do it, regardless. The reflecting pool's off to my left, dark and glassy. Mile 6 of a planned 10, all under 7.5 minutes so far. A solid pace tonight, better than usual. It's the looming storm that's spurring me on. We've had a week of early spring, unseasonably warm temperatures, the kind that coax buds from bare tree branches, tulip stalks from the soil. But the weather? It can turn on a dime here in the district, and the forecast says we're due for one last blast of winter. Wind's already picking up. I pass the World War II Memorial, start up the incline to the Washington Monument. I'm in my element here, muscles working, stretching, strengthening, pushing myself. I'm in a light jacket, running pants that hit mid-calf. My head's bare, hair pulled back, tied up away from my neck. 80s rock in my earbuds, but quietly. Soft enough that I'd hear someone approach. I'm fully aware of my surroundings. At the top, I catch a glimpse of the White House. Off to my left, glowing bright. Still gives me a thrill to see it, even after years in the city. A constant reminder that I'm close to the highest reaches of power. And where there's power, there's a need for what I do. Past the monument now, heading down the incline, picking up speed. The Capitol dome is ahead, illuminated against the night sky. A memory fills my mind just for an instant. Me, in that wood-paneled office all those years ago. Him, standing up from behind his desk, coming toward me. Focus, Steph. It's that damned case at work that's doing it, making me think of the past. I force my legs to work harder, push harder, move faster. Listen to the slap of my feet hitting the pavement, the staccato rhythm. The National Mall stretches out in front of me. A straightaway, a chance to test my speed. My legs are straining. There's pain in my knee, but I push through. Not giving up now. The dome looms large ahead. I see his face in my mind once again. I can feel his hand on my arm, squeezing tight. Faster still, almost a sprint. I can't change the past. Can't do anything about him, not without jeopardizing everything that matters. But I can do something about the future. I can stop someone else. I glance down at my wrist. 5.5-minute mile. I can feel the smile come to my lips. I've got this. Tomorrow, power gets policed. 4 in the afternoon, and Hansen's already at the bar. I'd never pegged him as a drinker back at Quantico. Maybe he changed, or maybe he hit it well. A bell chimes as I open the door, a tinny, ringing echo. The place is a dive, narrow and dark. Neon signs on the walls, a couple of pool tables, both in use. Journeys playing on the sound system. Don't stop believing. I let my eyes adjust for a moment. He's toward the far end of the bar, a glass in front of him, nearly full. I walk over, feeling stares, ignoring them. I know I'm a fish out of water here. Black pantsuit, high heels, tailored wool coat. Plenty of bars in DC attract that sort of crowd. This isn't one of them. Hey, Hansen. He turns. He's thicker around the middle than last time I saw him, thinner on top. A smile spreads across his face. Maddox. Well, I'll be damned. He half stands, leans in for an awkward hug. Awkward because we haven't seen each other in years, and because I can't think of a time we'd ever hugged. Back at the academy, he'd probably have greeted me with a slap on the back. His face colors, like he knows it was the wrong move. Like it dawned on him too late that we're not equals anymore. Not colleagues, not really. One-time friends. I avert my eyes from the flush, slip off my coat. Slide onto the stool beside him. A bartender walks over almost as soon as I'm sitting. What can I get you? She asks. resting her hands on the bar, leaning forward. There's a tattoo on the inside of her wrist, a heart wrapped in spiky barbed wire. My eyes travel from that to her face, innocent looking. Just water, thanks. She walks off, and I turn back to Hansen.
It's been too long, he says.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.